أشرف الأنبياء والنبيين محمد،
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المكرمين الغرر الميامين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. وأما بعد، قال الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، أقم الصلاة لدلوك الشمس إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر إن قرآن الفجر كان مشهودا، ومن الليل فتهجد به نافلة لك عسى أن يبعثك ربك مقاما محمودا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. The human beings have been created from two main aspects. The first is our physical existence. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within the Holy Quran states that He created us out of clay. And after He created human beings out of clay, came the more important aspect, or the second aspect, the superior aspect. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي. Then I blew into Adam from my own soul. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine and unlimited soul, His own existence. And of course, the soul is part of every human being's body, because a body without a soul is a dead body, is a body that does not move. Does not have any sort of function. The first element that is made of this earth, the clay of this earth, is very similar to the earth itself. Basically, the earth was created one day, and one day will vanish. The earth is limited by time and space. Therefore, our bodies will also be limited by time. One day they came about, one day they were created, and one day they will end up vanishing. And similar to the earth, just like the earth occupies a certain body, certain space, that our bodies also occupy a certain space. However, the soul that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us does not occupy any space, and it is not limited by time, because it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah's existence is not an existence that had a beginning, neither it is an existence that will have an end. Similarly, the abilities of the soul is also unlimited, because it comes directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So with our physical abilities, with our physical bodies, there's so much we can do. For example, we can use our bodies and travel long distances by using airplanes or cars or trains or different means of transportation. But we can never really travel back with time with our bodies. We can never instantly travel, for example, thousands of miles away. But with our souls, we can instantly travel thousands and thousands of miles away. So if I were to say, for example, Karbala, those who have been to Karbala, immediately they will picture Karbala. Immediately their souls will depart to, for example, Karbala. Or if I were to say, for example, Lebanon, many people can instantly travel back to Lebanon. If I were to say the day of Ashura, even though we have not been there, even though it is thousands of years away and thousands of miles away, some of us, through our souls, would be able to picture the day of Karbala. If I were to say Imam Hussein or Imam Ali or Rasulullah, many of us would have a picture that comes not through the body, but through the soul. Allah has asked us to nourish the body. وَلَا تَلْقُوا بِأَنفُسِكُمْ إِلَى التَّحْلُكَ. We have to take care of this body, we have to nourish the body, we have to feed the body. That is why we have to eat three times a day, sometimes four times a day. We have to exercise. And we also try our best to maintain a good physical appearance. And don't think that's not Islamic. Many people tell you, well, doesn't matter how I look. I mean, Islamically, the more simple you look, the more holy you are. Is that a true statement? No. Islamically, Islam, Rasulullah, the Holy Quran have taught us that we must look presentable, we must look good. In fact, including when we come to the masjid, خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. Make sure you wear the best of your attires, you look good, you look presentable, especially when you come to the masjid. Anyhow, so we take care of our bodies, we feed our bodies, and we come to the more important aspect, which is our spiritual existence. And we ask, how do we nourish our spiritual existence? Does it need nourishing? Do we need to take care of it? As in many of us, we understand that it is haram for us to eat haram food, you know. It is haram for us to eat the food that has not been slaughtered in the Islamic way, right? Many of us also understand that, for example, we cannot consume alcohol. Many of us also understand that, for example, we cannot consume different types of meats because they are not allowed in the religion of Islam. That all goes back to our physical aspect, harming our physical aspect. But what type of damage does it do to us spiritually? Damage we don't really feel. As if I were to say to someone, jump off a building. They'll say, why would I do that? Say, well, why wouldn't you jump off a building? Say, I'm going to hurt myself. I'm going to break a bone. See, physically, we feel the damage immediately. We feel the damage instantly. And we go and we see a doctor and a physician, a surgery room, and we fix the problem. But spiritually, we don't really feel the pain. And we don't really feel the damage that we have done to our spiritual existence unless we look into it. Unless we want to see that spiritual state. So if I tell someone to jump off a building, they won't do it. But if I tell them, here's a glass of wine, would you drink it? They'll say, yeah, why not? It's not going to do too much harm. It's going to do the exact same harm, if not more. But it's just you're not going to feel the pain inside your body, but your soul will definitely feel the pain. Let me give you one example. Imam al-Sadiq says, every time you look at something haram, whether it's opposite gender, whether it's something haram, anyhow, there are many things that are haram and we are aware that we shouldn't be looking at them. Every time you look at something haram, it's an arrow from the arrows of shaitan that land in our eyes. Do we feel that arrow? It's not like I look at something haram and I suddenly say, oh my God, I just felt that arrow land in my eyes. That arrow lands in my spiritual sight. That arrow lands directly in my spiritual vision. So 1, 2, 3, 10, 20 arrows of shaitan every day, I no longer can see. 10 arrows in the heart, 10 arrows in the eyes, 10 arrows in the mind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ بِهَا وَآذَانٌ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ بِهَا. They have eyes they don't see with. Allah says in the Quran, they have eyes they don't see with. Allah here is not referring to blind people. And they have hearts, but they cannot judge with. They have minds they cannot use and evaluate with. And they have ears they cannot hear with. Why? Because they have been spiritually damaged. That is why a mu'min and a believer sometimes may vary, his opinion may vary from many other people. As in you have 10, 12 people, and you would see something differently than others. When the mu'min likewise hears the Quran or reads the Quran, may see and hear things that others are not realizing. And that is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, I've given you those ears, use them. Use them in order to obey me, not disobey me. And Allah says, in shakartum, la'azidannakum. How are we thankful when we have ears? وَإِن كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. If I have those ears, and I want to be thankful, so I use them in order to hear what pleases Allah. And Allah says, when you're thankful in such a manner, I will increase. إِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. But if you use it to go against me, to use my disobedience, to use them for my disobedience, وَإِن كَفَرْتُمْ فَإِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. So those ears will hear better, will have a powerful, empowered ability to hear, gifted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we were to be thankful with those ears. And I don't necessarily mean a mu'min will be able to hear things, for example, from the next room, while someone that's not a mu'min will not be able to hear that. That's not what I mean. I mean we will hear things differently. We will judge things differently. We will see things differently, and we will use our intellect differently, because that will all be gifts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the person that is using his physical abilities in the right way. That is the physical aspect. The spiritual aspect, does it need nourishing? My soul, does it need nourishing? Absolutely. The soul needs nourishing, and the nourishment of the soul is 5 times a day. Through our salah. أقم الصلاة لدلوك الشمس إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر إن قرآن الفجر كان مشهودا. Salah is the greatest spiritual journey a believing man or woman can ever embark on. You've all heard of Mi'raj, right? What was Mi'raj? Mi'raj was when the Prophet elevated all the way to the first heaven, and then the second heaven, and then the third, and then the fourth, and then the fifth, and then the sixth, and then the seventh. And at the seventh heaven, he was accompanied by the angel Jibra'il. The angel Jibra'il said, "Ya Muhammad, from this point on, you will keep on elevating, but I cannot come with you. So Rasulullah said, "Why? Ya Habibi, Ya Jibra'il, why are you neglecting me? Why are you leaving me in such a state?" So Jibra'il said, "Ya Rasulullah, this position that you're about to embark on right now, this territory that you're about to conquer right now, no human being has ever conquered before. And no angel is allowed to embark on such a journey. In fact, I, Jibra'il, لو دنوت أنملة لاحترقت. If I were to take another step, 1 inch further, Allah will burn me down. This is only for you, Ya Rasulullah." So Rasulullah, after the seventh heaven, went to Arsh Allah, فدنا فتدلى فكان قاب قوسين أو أدنى. He came back. The Muslim said, "Ya Rasulullah, how was the Mi'raj?" He gave them hadith al-Mi'raj. "Ya Rasulullah, are we allowed to go on Mi'raj? Are we able to go on Mi'raj?" Rasulullah said, "As-salatu Mi'raj al-mu'min." Every one of you is allowed. Every one of you can indeed conquer that position with your one salah. 2 rak'ah of the morning prayers. As-salat Mi'raj al-mu'min. But how is it that when we tell many of the youth, "Why don't you pray?" I say, "My parents pray. I don't see the results. I mean, why are they praying, seriously? They just bow down, get up, sit down, sit back up. What does this do? I don't see any results. I see it pointless." Obviously, when we evaluate the concept and the notion of salah through my parents' salah, through my uncle's salah, through my aunt's salah, it's not going to work. It's not really going to be motivating for me to pray. It is only motivating when I understand the philosophy behind salah. It is only motivating and moving when I know how much this prayer can affect my spiritual existence. As in, we spend so much money on our physical existence. The best food, the best clothes, the best haircuts, the best, I don't know, shoes, the best watch, and anything that has to do with our physical appearance. We try to look good, we try to spend enough money, we try to spend enough time. But our spiritual existence, what about that? Allah says 5 minutes a day, 17 rak'ahs a day, 1 minute each rak'ah, 17 minutes. That's it. 17 minutes. Less than an hour, the time we spend on our breakfast. 17 minutes is the wajib. That's all we need to do for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throughout the day. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse, chapter 17, verse 79, says, "أقم الصلاة." Establish salah. أقم الصلاة. What does this mean? Why doesn't Allah just say pray? Pray. Salli. Why does He say establish salah? Why is it that every time We hear the statement of salah, it is initiated and associated with aqim as-salah, iqamat as-salah. And when we do the ziyarah of the ma'soom, we say ashhadu annaka qad aqamta as-salat. Why don't we say ashhadu annaka sallayt? Ashhadu annaka qad aqamta as-salat wa atayta az-zakat. When we come to zakat, we don't say wa aqamta az-zakat. We don't say wa aqamta al-hajj. But when we come to salah, we say ashhadu annaka qad aqamta as-salat. And Allah in the Holy Quran says aqim as-salata lidulook ash-shamsi ila ghasaq al-layl. Why? Have we ever thought about that? Aqim as-salah means establish salah. How do you establish salah? It's different to pray than to establish salah. The Mufassirin have stated establishing salah is when we pray in the right time. Praying in the right time. As in many of us, there is a movie, you know, and time of salah, it's okay. We'll let it slide. Maybe when the movie's over, 2 hours, an hour and a half later, we'll pray. Or for example, we are chatting with our friends. We're sitting and chatting with our friends and it's a time of salah. And my father comes to me, son, did you pray? No, it's just, I'm finishing up some homework I have. Homework? Even if you have homework, your homework can wait. If you're doing Fuhr and Asr, that's 8 minutes. Your homework can wait 8 minutes? And of course, for many of us, you know, the ones that concentrate on their salah, it's 8 minutes. For some, it's 2 minutes, the whole Dhuhr and Asr, so 1 minute each. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Salaamu Alaikum wa Rahmatullah. That's the whole prayer. When did you start? The Malaika don't even have time to understand, you know, that salah. That's not how it works. So aqim as-salah is the right time, giving importance to the right time. And what's interesting is some people say it. We pray dhuhr on time, asr on time, maghrib and isha on time. But this morning prayer, really, this is something we can't do. So I say, okay, fine. I'm not going to claim that I do it every single day on time. In fact, there's no one here that says, I've never missed a salah, morning salah. It's difficult. But it's how you treat it. I mean, if you have alarm clocks and you're ready and you want to wake up and you don't wake up, it's okay. You can make it up later. But it's not like I don't have any alarms on. I've never asked people to wake me up. I don't even care to wake up. And I say, well, I just couldn't wake up. Well, you're not going to wake up. You're not going to wake up if there is no alarm clock at 5 o'clock in the morning. So some people say, well, we have more important things. For example, if I don't sleep, enough sleep, the next day I can't function at work. Or for example, I have a very important meeting on Saturday. So on Saturday, am I going to put on my alarm clock for Salat al-Subh? Monday, I'll put it back on, you know. So 2 days off, what's the problem? You know what the problem is? Who are you meeting when you go to that meeting? Who? You're meeting just a normal human being, right? Even if it's the president, he's just a normal human being. But for that prayer, you're meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now who's more important? Ask yourself. First of all, we have to ask ourselves, who do we even live for? Do we live for Allah? Or do we live for ourselves? Because if you live for yourself, it's okay. You just shouldn't depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you need Him. You shouldn't really go to Him when you need Him because you're independent, you know? Independent of Allah, you can manage everything on your own. You really don't need His help. But if you're trying to live a life with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then the time where He requires you for your meeting, you must be present. So one is establishing salah in the right time. Number two is establishing salah in the right state. As in many people, they pray on time, but they don't pray the right prayer. As in they'll read it fast, or they don't know the laws. Or some people, for example, amongst the sisters, do we know the laws concerning salah when it comes to women? For example, the laws concerning wudu and nail polish. The laws, for example, concerning certain times where we cannot pray. the hijab while salah. As if you don't have full hijab during salah, the salah is going to be void. Now don't come and tell me, say, Allah, why do I need to wear hijab? I mean, if I'm by myself in my room and there's no one there, why do I need to wear hijab in salah? Why is that important? I mean, does Allah, do I need to cover up from God? Let me ask you something. If there was no dress code for salah, would that salah put you in that spiritual state, as in you just walked out of the shower, and that's it, you stand up and pray. Nobody's there. Would it put you in that spiritual state? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala therefore has put sets of laws. For what? For the men to wear? What for the woman to wear? How to do hajj? How to give homes? How to do zakat? How to do amr ma'ruf? How to do nahi an munkar? So that those set of laws manage us. So that we just don't wear what we like. We wear what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes for us to wear. And that's how we go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This prayer is for Him. So we go to Him the way He wants us to go to Him. So establishing salah with the right rules. And we have to understand those rules. We cannot just say, well, Allah is so merciful, He'll accept any way for me to pray. Allah is very merciful, indeed. Allah is so merciful, we're going to pray, we're going to fast, we're going to try our best. But at the end of the day, I guarantee you, Allah, if He judges you with His justice, nobody will end up in paradise. As if Allah were to judge us with our justice, would any one of us enter in paradise? At the end of the day, we will require and need Allah's mercy to enter paradise. But let's not push it. Allah has laws, Allah has regulations. And the more we are respectful of His laws, the more He will be respectful of our wishes. Aqim as-salah. There are many discussions revolving aqim as-salah. The right time, the right place, the right clothes. Many people tell you, as long as my clothes are tahir, your tahir, tahara. Some people say, as long as the food that I eat, I want to make sure that people understand this. Some people say, as long as the food that I'm eating is halal. Can you explain to me what halal means? Well, halal means slaughtered from the Islamic way, al-qibla, you know. There's no other definition to halal? There is a greater definition. That money has been purchased from a halal way. Yeah. If that money has not been purchased through the halal way, you're better off just buying any sort of meat. Because it's going to end up being haram anyways. If that attire or the clothes that I'm wearing comes from halal ways, legitimate ways, yes. And it has to be tahir. So there's two aspects. Tahir and halal, purchased through a halal way. Good. If that clothes or that attire is tahir all day long, but it's been purchased through illegitimate ways, that salah is batil. End of story. All of our ulama say if a person has not paid his khums, listen to me, 20% of the clothes that he wears does not belong to him, and that is ghasb. Ghasb is something disliked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salah is something liked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and desired. وَعُلَمَا say المبعد, which is غصب لا يكون مقربا. Listen to the statement. المبعد لا يكون مقربا. As in you're saying, أصلي ركعتين صلاة الصبح قربة إلى الله. It's supposed to get you closer. That prayer is meant to take you to Allah. So that's مقرب. قربة إلى الله. مقرب. But when you're doing it while غصب, it's not taking you. It's something disliked by Allah. Allah is saying you're doing ghasb. You're taking someone else's right. How can you use that and come to me? Al-muba'id la yakunu muqarriba. It's a very simple statement. And all of our ulama have a consensus on this matter. Let's give importance to it. Aqim as-salat. Then Allah in chapter 7 discusses the times of salah. Number 1, liduluk al-shams, noon, ila ghasaq al-layl. Night time, so it's not the beginning of Maghrib, It's the end of Maghrib when it's called Layl, nighttime. إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر. إن قرآن الفجر كان مشهودا. And the time of Fajr is the third time. Now why does Allah say مشهودا? As in the Quran of Dhuhr is not مشهود. The Quran of Asr is not مشهود. مشهود means witness. So the Dhuhr prayer is not witnessed. Asr prayer is not witnessed. Yes, all of them are witnessed. But this one is witnessed by the angels of the night and the angels of the day. So the angels of the night write the salah for you and the Quran. And the angels of the day will also write the salah for you and the Quran. إِنَّ قُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ كَانَ مَشْهُودًا وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ مو كل الليل وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَتَهَجَّدْ بِهِ نَافِلَةً لَكْ عسى أن يبعثك ربك مقاما محمودا. صلاة الليل, صلاة الليل, that one ركعة of صلاة الليل, ركعة في جوف الليل تطفئ نيرانا من غضب الرب. One ركعة of the night prayers turns off and extinguishes ultimate fires of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have created with our sins. Brothers, we know we've created fire for ourselves. We know we've compiled sins. One rak'ah in the middle of the night. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Musa, kadhiba man za'ama annahu yuhibbuni wa ila janna al-layl nama'an. Ya Musa, lie those who say that they love me, but when the night time comes, they sleep and they forget me. One rak'ah of salah. وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَتَهَجَّدْ بِهِ نَافِلَةً لَكْ عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَبْعَثَكَ رَبُّكَ مَقَامًا مَحْمُودًا. Go read Surah Al-Muzzammil, brothers and sisters. Muzzammil. يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُزَّمِّلْ قُمِ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا نِصْفَهُ أَوْ انْقُصْ مِنْهُ قَلِيلًا أو زد عليه ورتل القرآن ترتيلا. إنا سنلقي عليك قولا ثقيلا. إن ناشئة الليل هي أشد وطئا وأقوى مقيلا. Until Allah in the last ayah says what? إن ربك يعلم أنك تقوم أدنى من ثلثي الليل ونصفه وثلثه وطائفة من الذين معك والله يقدر الليل والنهار علم أن لن تحصوه فتاب عليكم. يعني إيش تاب عليكم؟ يعني يا جماعة واجب بس لأن ما فيكم تصلوا طول الليل فتاب عليكم فاقرأوا ما تيسر منه. فاقرأوا أمر, فاقرأوا ما تيسر منه وأقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة وأقرضوا الله قرضا حسنا. Allah says part of the layl you have to read the Quran. Part of the layl you have to converse with Allah. And if you're traveling or you are at war, Allah forgives you. Meaning in the rest of the time, this is your duty. وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَتَهَجَّدْ بِهِ نَافِلَةً لَكْ عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَبْعَثَكَ رَبُّكَ مَقَامًا مَحْمُودًا. For many people, once again going back to the introduction, how do we know that my salah is accepted? How do I know that this salah is not accepted? Many people ask, Sayyid, how do I know my salah is accepted? Or why am I praying? Same answer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in chapter 5 verse number 6 says, the salah must refrain you from shameful and unjust acts. إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. If your salah is stopping you from fahsha and munkar, shameless acts, sinful acts, unjust acts, then your salah is accepted. If it is not stopping you, the salah is not being accepted. Go look at where the problem is. Go investigate. See which part of my salah is wrong. I need to fix it. Because the salah is meant to eliminate you and refrain you from the evil acts. There are some delicate points. I'll cover them before the Q&A, inshallah. But before I conclude my lecture about salah, and inshallah I'll speak about this further after the lecture, before the Q&A starts, before we take some questions, inshallah, I will cover some more aspects that I could not cover today. But I'll finally conclude with this statement. Adhan and wudu are indeed the most important.